The 2013 Maranatha Lecture was presented by Sir Peter Fahy, the Chief Constable of Greater Manchester Police Force. Quoting from the Bible, Sir Peter chose the title, "Do not judge, and you will not be judged." The challenges of being a police officer and a Christian, and the balance between punishment, rehabilitation, and blame. The lecture took place in the Western Theatre of Manchester Conference Centre. Juan Fernandez Arias, co-leader of the Maranatha community, acted as compere, and the evening was introduced by Dennis Wrigley, the leader and founder of the community, who prayed for us, set the scene, and introduced Sir Peter Fahy.
Right at the very beginning, it needs to be laid down that the purpose of this lecture is to focus attention on what God would have for this city and for this region. The gospel is indivisible. The transformation offered by Christ is total. And we are, I believe, now facing a major situation in this nation. Some would say there's even a struggle for the soul of the nation taking place, and I would be with them. And therefore, when we look at the police, we see here one of the great pillars of security, of continuity, of justice, and of peace. And it's no coincidence that we have the Chief Constable of Manchester coming at a time when there's quite a national debate about the role of the police in our communities and in our society. And therefore, I believe the first thing we must do is to ask God to use this meeting tonight. So shall we therefore pray? Lord Jesus Christ, you came to transform the world. You come now to bring peace, to bring justice, to bring hope. As we see human suffering writ large in the Far East with all the storms, we know that you are a God of compassion. So, Lord, tonight, lead our thoughts that this city, this region, may be blessed by you, that all of us may receive a vision of what might be. Amen. Now I'm going to welcome Sir Peter. It's a tremendous joy to have you here. We're all aware of the heavy responsibilities on your shoulders. We're all aware not just of the nearly 2.5 million people who you serve and over whom you exert authority, but we're aware that this city has been a very important place in the development of our nation, not just in terms of law and order and public health and education, but also in terms of the vast numbers of missionaries who are sent all over the world from within 40 miles of where we are today, hundreds and thousands of them. And therefore, it is significant that we should have the honour and the privilege of hearing you as Chief Constable of our city and of our region. We do welcome you. We thank you for already the inspiration we know that you have given to many. We thank you for your concern, especially for the young. And in your previous post in Cheshire, we've learnt so much about your compassion for the wounded and the hurting of this world. And therefore, it's with immense joy and pleasure that I ask you to address us and give to us this second Maranatha lecture.
Thank you very much. It's really good to be here tonight. I think all people of faith You know, you understand you're under an obligation to try and spread the message and speak about your faith, but I think a lot of people actually find that difficult. You know, they don't want to stand on street corners and preach. So I do regard myself as incredibly privileged that in my position I do get the chance to actually go to different groups and talk about my faith. And so it is a great privilege, and so I'm really grateful for you allowing me to speak about that here tonight. I find it a little bit interesting, actually, that we're here in this building, because the only other time each year that I come into this building is actually because here the police contingent gathers for Gay Pride every year. And that caused me a little bit of dilemma there, really, to a degree. What's a good Catholic boy doing at Gay Pride? And that probably highlights my responsibility to all communities and to the whole city. But also about the thing that festivals like Pride are actually about against intolerance. They're not saying that everybody's got to be gay, they're not endorsing a particular lifestyle, but it is saying that we all need to stand together against intolerance and against hatred. So as I say, I'm not here to preach to you. And I suppose, you know, one of the first things really, and I've picked out this particular theme, judge not and you will not be judged, because the whole issue about judging, linked to law enforcement, the way we view other people, the way we view behaviour, I felt was a key theme to try and explore some of the dilemmas of being a police officer. And really it was said a little bit in the introduction, because I suppose one of the first things I thought about is almost, what is your right to stand up and speak about this? Some people will say you should actually keep your faith quiet. It's a personal thing. Public servants, personalities, whatever, should keep quiet about it, should not speak about it. But it's not. I don't agree with that. As was said in the introduction, I have great power over you. You might say, well, quite a few other people have power over our lives. Doctors have power over your lives. On the other hand, if you go and see your doctor and the doctor says, I think you need this operation, you can decide, well, don't fancy the operation, or I don't want to take these drugs. If we turn up and say we're going to search your house or we're going to arrest you, whatever it might be, you don't get a lot of choice, actually. So, you know, we do have a lot of power over your lives. It is not just an issue of running a huge organisation with about 13,000 staff. It is actually that it's a constitutional position as well. I, as Chief Constable, have duties under the law. In some ways, I'm the interface between the power of the state and the protection of the citizen. So actually, I think it is quite important that people in Greater Manchester do understand a little bit about what actually drives me. But I do also personally think it is important for people to speak out about themselves. I think we should live in a society where absolutely people can be individuals, that they can talk about what particularly motivates them, that they don't feel they've got to fit a particular mould, and therefore if what affects them and is important to them is their religious faith, then they should absolutely be able to speak up about it. There is a bit of a mood at the moment that actually chief constables should keep quiet, that we hear too much about them. I certainly don't think chief constables should be personalities. On the other hand, we are professionals. I get a great privilege in terms of seeing all sorts of aspects of life across Greater Manchester. And therefore, I think it is right for me, and it's part of my accountability to the public and to the press, that I should speak out about things, that I should make my views known, if nothing else, so people can challenge and criticise me. But also, as I say, given that I've got all this information about what's going on, I think it is really important that I actually speak about it. That said, I think I'm really, really passionate about that the police force should never get involved in party politics. And the fact that some individuals, it seems to me, have, are at the heart perhaps of some of the issues that we've had over the last few weeks. Just want to start with my own personal story. I grew up in East London, good Catholic lad, as I said, and actually went to church every week, and there was a church youth club, and it was actually run by a Metropolitan Police officer, and he sort of got me interested in being a police officer. But did well at school, went to university, studied languages, and at the end of university thought, what am I going to do? Do I want to join the police? Do I want to do something else? And there were actually a lot of accountancy firms that were recruiting at that time, and I thought, well, you could be an accountant, international qualification, you can travel around the world, you can use your languages. And so in the end, that's what I did. And I went off to work for a big American company called Arthur Andersen. They actually came to grief during the Enron scandal. But I worked in a very plush office in London, was sent away to Paris for 2 weeks for training. But one day, about after 3 months, I was in the London office, decided to have a walk out for lunch and walked actually down to Fleet Street, which, if you remember, was the place where the papers used to be printed. And it was actually the last day of publication of the old London Evening News, which I used to read right the way through my childhood. My family always bought it. And there were a lot of guys standing around there who were going to be made redundant that very afternoon. I looked to them and thought, I've lost my connection with you. And I went back to the office and handed in my resignation and joined the police. And that's not to say that people who work for accountancy firms or in business or anything else don't have a vocation, but it wasn't my particular vocation. And I felt very strongly at that point that, I'll be honest, that God was calling me. There certainly was some voice that was instigating me to make a very sudden decision in my life. And really as well, at times then during my career, when things have got a bit difficult, when there's been dilemmas, when I've wondered, you know, what's the purpose of this? I have been able to remind myself at the end of the day, I do feel this is the vocation that God has called me to, not just to be a police officer, but also to be a leader. So as I say, I've picked up on this issue about judge not and you will not be judged, because on the face of it, it causes a few problems, doesn't it, the gospel, for being a police officer, because it says there you're not supposed to judge people. Well, you know, a lot of the time in being a police officer, you're making judgments about people. There's that difficult line about setting prisoners free. Gosh, there's a difficult one, isn't it? Am I supposed to go down to strange ways and open all the doors? I think, on the other hand, as you get older, don't you, you realise actually that there are lots of other prisons besides the brick-built ones, that there are all sorts of people in prisons of addiction, of obsession with material goods, whatever it might be. And I think that's actually what the gospel was very much saying. Very key theme in the gospel, absolutely, obviously, about forgiveness. Again, as a police officer, you know, obviously, you are taking people to court. You're ensuring that they've got, they're getting a punishment. So is there a contradiction there? And, you know, things like the gospel says very firmly, if somebody assaults you, then offer them the other cheek. Well, again, that's not something you do as a police officer. But on the other hand, I think, you know, importantly within the gospel, there are many references throughout the Bible to actually punishing wrongdoing, about protecting the weak and the vulnerable. There's quite a lot of references to judges. Moses in the Old Testament was told to appoint judges to sort out disputes among the people. And of course, our Lord very much said about rendering unto Caesar what is Caesar's. So, you know, very much for me endorsing the fact that with any nation, there has to be government, there has to be law and order, there has to be a system. But as I say, at the end of the day, it is my particular vocation. And while people may have an image of policing that it is about sort of being tough, that it is about enforcing the law, that it is about using force, that is not actually the day-to-day. The day-to-day of policing is largely about helping people in difficult situations, being alongside people at the very worst moments in their lives. Enormous opportunities to show patience and compassion. And that's on the whole what I see my staff do day in, day out. People think we spend most of our time dealing with crime. Actually, we spend most of our time dealing with vulnerable people. And if you talk to most operational officers, they will certainly say the number one issue at the moment is mental health. So actually, within being a police officer, there are enormous opportunities to show compassion, to show understanding, to show compassion. And I can say on the whole, from what I see of my officers every single day, often faced with great frustrations, great provocation, lots of difficult situations. As I say, they show huge amounts of compassion and understanding. So taking that into account, this particular quote from Matthew, judge not and you will not be judged, it's certainly not saying that all judging is wrong. I'm going to explore this during the lecture, during my talk tonight, but it's certainly not saying that all judging is wrong. And certainly when you look at the court system, judging in that situation, on the whole, is about hopefully getting a series of facts, being about a search for the truth and making a decision based on these facts. I think on the whole, what my Lord was saying in that particular quotation It is about how you make judgments, and particularly how you make judgments about people's values and about people's motives. And I think very much, isn't it, it's a very strong theme in the gospel, which is against hypocrisy. You know, the line about looking at the speck in your brother's eye and ignoring the beam in your own eye. I think on the whole there is a very strong message in the gospel against hypocrisy, the way that our Lord was constantly confronting the scribes and the Pharisees because of the gap between the law that they said everybody had to comply with and their own particular conduct. And I think one of my favourite stories in the gospel is actually the woman taken in adultery, which I think is a very, very powerful scene, almost a cinematic scene of all these people ready to throw stones and a Lord saying, who is without sin can cast the first stone, and the way that the crowd just melted away. And I think that's a very, very powerful story. So I think what our Lord is saying on this whole issue about judging the way we judge other people, he's essentially saying, you've got to judge yourself first. You've got to judge yourself first. And that, I think, is a key theme about being a police officer and about being a leader. It is about the standard you set. It is about really what drives you, your own personal values, your own personal ethics. If you are going to, for instance, book somebody for speeding, then really as a police officer, you'd be pretty careful that you don't speed yourself. And as was said, there's quite a debate in policing about this at the moment. Recently, the College of Policing published a code of ethics, which covers issues like honesty, integrity, the use of force, accepting hospitality and gifts. Some people have lampooned it, that why do you need a code of ethics to tell police officers not to drink on duty and things like that? Well, you don't really, but it is about a starting process to have a serious debate within policing about how we make judgments, about how we make decisions, and this crucial issue about our own personal standards and the way that we actually enforce the law. And it causes us all, it causes certainly police officers, but I think it causes us all really to think about what is it that we actually stand for. And for me, you know, having thought quite a bit about this, I think as a police officer, but also as a leader, if not as an individual, you need to be pretty clear. You need to try and work out what is it you actually believe in as a professional. You know, what is the style of policing you actually believe in works? I think you've got to be clear about what you believe as a leader in terms of your own personal values, your standards, your impact on other people. And for me, running a big organisation, I've got to be clear about my own values and actually running that organisation and some of the decisions I've got to make. And that really, I suppose, for me, is where my own faith comes in, because that obviously creates quite a strong foundation for you, you know, basing your own values. But I also think, you know, for me personally, I think it is really important that you do carve out a bit of time each day and each week to reflect on your own values, you know, to reflect on your own conscience. You know, the Christian way examination of your conscience, for me, it's taking the dogs out in the morning. It's been able to say some prayers. It's just that point of where you can just have a think, press the pause button on a very, very busy day, and actually think about your own values, about the day ahead, perhaps the day yesterday, and whether you're staying firm to that. And that's why going to church is so important for me every week, because it's that little bit of pause, that little hour, where I can become Peter Fahy, not the Chief Constable of Greater Manchester, and look at myself, and as I say, really just stand back and have a think about, are you holding firm to those values? And so I personally think that is really, really important. I talk quite a lot about that to my own staff in terms of, as I say, their own values, their own ethics, that you actually have that very clear idea about your own set of values. Some people call that conscience, and it's absolutely not just, you know, people of faith that have this. I think all professionals should certainly develop it. But there is almost something spiritual about having almost that set of values that you try and stick to, and that notion almost of a conscience, and that notion almost of a foundation that you keep on returning to make sure that you're trying to hold on to your own values in what can often be a very complex world in terms of the dilemmas you face. And as I say, as a police officer, some of that is reasonably straightforward, as I say, about using honesty, about issues, about the example you set. But actually, in day-to-day, there are much more serious dilemmas that you face as a police officer. And I certainly think that, particularly with things like the budget cuts, some of those dilemmas grow even greater in terms of the way you use your power, the way you use resources, decisions that our officers have to make every single day about how they deal with different difficult situations. And therefore, if they have thought through their own values, if they're able to apply some logic to that situation, if they're able to be clear about their own decision making, then overall they're in a better position to be able to account for the decisions that they actually make. But it's also important, I think, you know, police officers need to set that personal example, but it's also important about, you know, what is the society that those police officers, and indeed any public servant, actually lives within. I've been a police officer for 32 years. When I first became a police officer, it was a very different legal system. There was no tape recording of interviews. Essentially, you had to go through a fiction whereby you interviewed somebody for, say, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, and you then went down supposedly to a report writing room and made a record of that interview. And you went along to court and you stood in a box, in the witness box, and you swore that it was the truth and the whole truth. And that record that you made was a verbatim record of the interview. Now, if I asked you now to make a record of my last 10 minutes, you'd find that impossible. But it was sort of a crazy system whereby everybody sort of accepted that it was a fiction. And that was really, so, you know, to be an effective police officer at that time, it was almost required that you tell lies. Thankfully, that whole system has changed since. But we always need to be wary of that. Another one which caused a lot of ethical dilemmas for police officers was the obsession with targets and league tables. So therefore, when you're trying to do your best as a police officer, when you're trying to serve the community, when you're trying to perhaps deal with an issue which presents the greatest threat, harm and risk, there was another driver coming down, which was the need to actually meet a particular target. And in some places that did drive particular ethical unethical behaviour. So what I'm saying is that if you want public servants to be ethical, obviously that is what you expect as members of the public, but it's also incumbent on the public and on society in creating a system which allows public servants to be ethical and doesn't put pressures on them, as I say, to have to compromise what they believe themselves as professionals. And certainly, you know, another one as a leader of an organisation, again, often you're under pressure to try and defend that, the reputation of that organisation. Sometimes you'll have lawyers saying to you, you know, you must not admit fault on this one, you must not admit liability, because otherwise the organisation will have to pay out. So in those sorts of situations, you've got to be very, very clear. But I often find that the media and other people can criticise public servants, but without actually recognising the system in which they actually operate. And one element really around that is, at the moment, the obsession with blame. And I've said some things about this recently and wrote a letter to The Guardian about it. That if you want public servants to be ethical, if you want police officers absolutely to be ethical, then part of that is the ability for people to admit mistakes. It is a big issue in the health service at the moment that you want the sort of culture that, for instance, if a nurse sees some unsatisfactory practice, if she sees a doctor, a colleague, behaving badly with a patient, you would hope that that nurse has got the confidence that, you know, he or she can report that, and it will be dealt with seriously but also dealt with proportionately. On the other hand, if there is a whole obsession with investigation, with trying to blame people in complex situations, with complex systems, all you're trying to find is a junior police officer or a junior social worker to try and take the blame, then the trouble is that doesn't, on the whole, create healthy or honest organisations. And so, you know, this whole issue about ethical behaviour, it's got to exist within a wider culture which actually prizes people for being open, for being transparent, and really where the public are willing to confront difficult issues and try to understand the reality of what public servants are dealing with. Often, quite rightly, quite understandably, there's a lot of public concern about situations where perhaps in awful tragedies, children die, and it's always said, you know, why did not somebody notice? Why didn't people take action? often people don't understand that those particular social workers, those particular teachers, those particular police officers are often dealing with hundreds of families like that. Hundreds of families often with chaotic lifestyles, you know, with really difficult decisions where often for a professional it's quite hard sometimes to even recognise where is normality in this situation. And where, you know, for instance, yes, you could put a child into care and that might offer some protection, but you know also on the whole that children in the care system long term are also harmed and damaged. So it's really important, as I say, that the public understand the reality in which public servants live in at the front line. And I personally believe there's a growing gap between the world I see often in the media, the world spoken of by certain commentators, particularly without showing a prejudice, commentators in London, the sort of world they describe and the world I see in deprived communities here in Greater Manchester, or for instance the world that you can go out and enjoy in Manchester city centre at 4 o'clock in the morning at the weekend. And the trouble is, if public servants feel that there is that gap, if social workers, police officers, people in the health service feel that the people that are judging them don't understand the environment in which they are operating, then that actually is a very difficult situation. Because again, public servants can easily feel demotivated and feel that the ethical dilemmas that they face are not actually being appreciated. I want to move that on now, really, also then to talk about how does that affect the criminal justice process. And in this issue about judging, this balance between rehabilitation and punishment, because again, the gospel constantly exhorts us, doesn't it, for us to show mercy. And again, that can be difficult when often society is looking for retribution and looking for punishment. Again, during my career, on the whole, the way the police service has developed is we've developed from being just really what was very much a reactive organisation and an organisation on the whole being about enforcing the law. And we've really now moved into a whole series of other areas. We've developed neighbourhood policing. And to use the jargon, we've tried to move upstream. We've tried to actually deal with some of the social problems which actually caused crime in the first place. And certainly we've done a lot more work to get a lot closer to deprived communities and to work within those communities. And of course, not everybody has appreciated that. Some people actually criticise for that and would like us to go back to a much purer or a much simpler law enforcement model, which is just about crime and criminals. But that is not really the world, as I say, that we live in. And overall, over that period, we have developed into a different form of policing. Some may see that as social work. I think on the whole, it is about prevention. It is about trying to make areas better overall. But it is about trying to solve the overall problem. And how can you work with other agencies, with voluntary groups, with churches, with other professionals, actually to make areas better? But if you think about some of that debate, certainly, for instance, some people are very in favour of zero tolerance. They said the answer to that is what happened in New York, and that really the police should take a hard line against all crimes. Well, for me, that doesn't show any tolerance. It doesn't show any discretion. It would cause, I think, real dilemmas for any police officer. Our style of policing is very much about an officer has discretion. And that when you're dealing with any situation, you try and look at it in the round. And that can be difficult. You are trying to take into account the motive of the offender. Have they shown remorse? You're absolutely listening to the victim. You're trying to put that into the context of what's important to this particular community. Is this particular type of offence, this particular crime, a particular problem, a particular concern in this community? And you make a judgment based on that. But really, to go just for zero tolerance just means you've got no real ability to show any forgiveness, any tolerance, and you're not allowing your own staff to use their discretion. In Victorian times, therefore, it was, you know, very much a sort of a quite clear divide between good and evil. And really a lot of our court system and our prison system is still based for me on that very Victorian ideal about good and evil. Again, that's not really the world that I live in. And I often talk to my new recruits that if you think you've joined a world where there's good and evil, you'll find very quickly it's not that simple. Very quickly you'll come across people, you'll think, well, if I had your upbringing, I may well have turned into a criminal as well. You come across people that are trapped in drug addiction, substance misuse, you find that most child abusers were actually abused as children themselves. So really, just to see it purely as good and evil, that's not really, as I say, the world we live in. You've got to try and look at the wider issues behind. There can be no question that serious criminals have to be punished. There is no question that the public need to be protected and that serious criminals need to be controlled. But when you're dealing with other situations, when you're dealing, as I say, to people that are driven by addiction, that are trapped by addiction, that are often trapped about their own personality, their inability to deal with relationships, when you're dealing with women that may have been provoked by many, many years of domestic violence to commit a violent crime, really this whole notion of judging starts getting really, really complex. So as I say, I'd want to be clear that wrongdoing needs to be punished. But I think what we've got to look at is the nature of that punishment and what its impact. For the most serious offences, there can be no question that punishment is there, prison is there as a punishment. But most offences are actually less serious. They're actually often about a pattern of offending. Most crime is actually committed by a relatively small number of persistent offenders. And for me, my personal philosophy is we should be really, really passionate about trying to help those who do want to rehabilitate, in the jargon, who want to go straight. But on the other hand, we should be pretty hard in controlling those who are not willing to change their pattern of behaviour and have developed and, you know, adopted an offending lifestyle. So it is about looking at issues like drugs, alcohol, poor relationships, and trying to understand that context of their offending. And it is, as I say, for me, how we can do more and more about rehabilitation. And that's really the philosophy that we have adopted. A number of examples. We have something called integrated offender management. It's a pretty awful term, but it's where we work police officers and probation officers very closely together. And that involves knowing when prisoners are going to be released from prison, going to see them before they are going to be released, having conversations about them, about where they're going to live, are they going to continue their drug treatment after they leave prison. It may well involve us actually collecting them from the gate of the prison to actually take them to the community to make sure they do, you know, we know where they're going to be living. It may well be helping them to get some food, issues like that. And the issue behind that is often for people in that situation, prison is an easy option, because prison means you get your three meals cooked a day and you can avoid lots of life's decisions. Actually living in the community, having to budget, having to write a shopping list, having to cook for yourself, as I say, possibly having a police officer and a probation officer visiting you twice a day to make sure you're keeping on the straight and narrow, that actually can be more challenging. We've done a huge amount of work with the Youth Offending Service. And again, that is an enormous success story in this country. We have had a huge drop in the level of youth offending. It's often not the story you get told about young people, but actually there's been a big drop in youth crime and a huge reduction in the number of young people going into custody. And that's again because the police have worked with probation, youth services, education, getting a lot better at picking up youngsters at the very start of their offending career and working really hard to try and turn them round. Not waiting till you almost get a point of crisis where you can't think of anything else to do, but to put them into custody. Now, some people may say, you've gone soft. Why are you doing this? Why are you giving people cautions? Why are you not taking people to court? Well, because we learnt very quickly that putting youngsters into custody, or indeed, on the whole, sending prisoners for short prison sentences, all it meant was that they came out as more damaged individuals and they came out as better criminals. So this is not being soft. It is actually saying that the best way to protect victims is to have less crime and less criminals. But obviously within that is, in some ways, you know, a very strong Christian message to a degree about forgiveness and about trying to help people in different points of their lives. We've developed that further into what we call restorative justice, which you may have heard about, which is essentially bringing offenders and victims together so that offenders can actually understand this was the impact this crime had on this victim. Often when you go to court, it can be a sort of, in a way, fairly anonymous process. The defendant doesn't actually meet the victim if they plead guilty. They don't hear the impact of the crime under restorative justice. They actually have to sit opposite the victim. They have to hear the story. They have to hear the impact They have to make some form of reparation. And we found that that is actually gives a lot more satisfaction to the victim, has a bigger impact on the offender. And it also helps the victim to realise that this person who committed this crime against them was not some big evil bloke in a mask and a swag bag on their back, but often was a pretty inadequate, sometimes stupid individual who'd had a difficult upbringing. And we've actually had situations where victims themselves have tried to help this person, realising the need that they've got. The next thing we want to move into is actually trying to reduce the number of women going into custody. If any of you have ever had the misfortune of going to Stile Prison, most of the women in there have got mental health problems. A lot of women, when you think about it, are in prison because of men, because they've been asked to carry drugs or get involved in drug dealing, or as I said earlier, because they've been provoked by such a level of domestic violence that they end up committing a serious assault themselves. So again, we are working with other agencies, with the probation service, but again, very much with local groups to try and see if we can offer alternatives. And again, it's not being soft. It is actually thinking, though, of other ways in which we can still punish but also confront offending behaviour. There's often one common theme behind a lot of these particular programmes, and that is the strength of mentoring. And again, quite a lot of people within churches, people of faith, but lots of other people as well, get involved in mentoring. This is about actually being alongside a person in need, often an ex-offender, to try and help them get through their life, to try and be a role model to them. The best person often to have an impact on a drug addict is somebody who's managed to clean themselves up. Often the biggest impact on somebody involved in gang activity is an ex-gang member. I heard of a wonderful project in Bolton whereby, without in any way stereotyping, but where a group of women of a certain age used to visit young offenders when they've come out of prison, and again try and help them to teach them some basic cooking skills and help them to actually write a shopping list. So it's that sort of activity. So again, there's a key role, and it's very easy to often think about, as I said, about offenders being big evil people. Would strike you down in the street if they saw you. That is not the reality. The reality is offenders are living in your community. They're living in your street. They're often people with all sorts of problems in their lives. And therefore, for that type of offender who's often commits relatively minor crime because of a particular lifestyle, because of being driven by addiction or whatever, there's a real role for the wider community to play a part in actually confronting that behaviour, but also helping people try and get through it. But what I'd want to be really, really clear about is for offenders who choose not to take up that offer, I think society needs to be a lot more effective in controlling those. It should not be that people have to commit so many burglaries before the court system decides to put some control around them. I also feel extremely strongly about those involved in organised crime. There are a certain group of people in this city who are driven by extremes of greed. That is their motive. The means of getting, committing crime is through extremes of violence. Some of the supposed Mr. Big, some of the people involved in organised crime, they're at the top of the tree because they're prepared to involve, to threaten and use extreme violence. It's not because they are particular, clever. And they often, they are the people who create the market in stolen goods. They often destroy communities because they offer to young people that they can get on, not by going to school and by studying, but by being one of those drug dealers who drive around in a big BMW, to stereotype. And they also are quite happy and prepared to flood a particular community with drugs to then ensnare very vulnerable people into that sort of lifestyle. So I've got to be honest, I don't have a huge amount of compassion for people like that. And I think the key thing is they need to control. And that really has been our philosophy in Greater Manchester Police. It is about all the work we do at a local neighbourhood level, working with local people, working with agencies, particularly trying to pick up young people who may be vulnerable to getting involved in offending, trying to work with other agencies in knowing who the local offenders are, and if possible, to actually change their behaviour, but if they're not willing to change their behaviour, to be targeting them. And then all the work that we've been doing against organised crime, which have seen, you know, quite a number of the major criminals in the city now behind bars. And really, by taking those out, you start creating the space in communities whereby the good people can assert themselves. We saw that most powerfully in the Moss Side area a few years ago, a dreadful record of people being shot. Moss Side being known, you know, for one particular thing. That area has now been transformed. And a lot of that doubt was down, you know, not just to good policing. Most of it was down actually to the local community saying, we've had enough, enough is enough. And particularly where the families and the parents were absolutely prepared to support police action in removing really dangerous people. And that, as I say, one of the key roles police can play is through enforcement, by dealing with some of the serious criminals in those sorts of communities, and then creating that space where the good people, the churches, the schools, all the rest of it, can do their work to try and rescue that community. And there are still some areas where that is absolutely what we're trying to do. So this is not, you know, it is not about being soft. It is about being very, very clear about the nature of crime and offending, and trying to adopt the right sort of strategies which is likely to impact upon that. But absolutely being prepared to say that you're willing to show mercy and compassion, and where people of good faith are willing to work together to try and help you know, people who want to turn away from an offending lifestyle. I now want to turn, I've talked about personal ethics, I've talked about crime and punishment. The third element I want to address in this issue around, you know, judge not and you will not be judged, is the issue about prejudice. It's crucially about really how we judge others, isn't it? And it's whether, you know, when we look at individuals, do we judge them in line with a stereotype and a label? And of course, religions in the past sometimes have be guilty about this sort of labelling. I think one of the really powerful messages given by the new Pope, Pope Francis, has been the way that he's confronted some of this, and again, particularly around gay people. And what we know, certainly in this city and elsewhere, is prejudice has really affected lives of people. It's affected minorities. It's affected people who are different. It's affected people of faith themselves. And it can absolutely destroy people's lives. We've seen that develop into people being labelled benefit scroungers and chavs and things like that, which I think, you know, on the whole is equally offensive, because you know, people have been labelled almost for being poor, and of course through that then it breeds alienation, and it particularly has the danger of getting sometimes very quite vulnerable, impressionable people then to carry out violence against those groups, and that develops into things like hate crime and discrimination and the loss of opportunity. And when I've thought about this, I'm actually very, very lucky, because, you know, in the great job that I do, I get to see all sorts of aspects of life across Greater Manchester and indeed beyond. Last Thursday, you know, last Friday, I was actually playing football on a dusty pitch in a shanty town in Kampala in Uganda, as part of the project we do with street children in Uganda with the charity Retrack. And then Monday night, I was in the House of Lords giving a speech there. I'm here tonight. Hopefully this week I'll get out and patrol, which may involve me, you know, standing in the room of a drug addict or a crime victim or whatever. Tomorrow I'll have the great privilege again of meeting Her Majesty the Queen. Friday night we're doing an event around Islamophobia. And so I have a great opportunity to meet all sorts of different people. And it constantly challenges my assumptions. And almost that most powerfully, it is about young people, isn't it? You know, young people often dreadfully stereotyped. Again, I get the great privilege of going to many prize givings, youth groups. I'm president of the boys and girls clubs. And every time you do that, you, as I say, you meet really committed young people who I personally think are a brighter hope for the future than some of us, really, because they don't often have some of the prejudices that we have. But the point I'm making, really, is that when I'm really lucky, I have the opportunity of seeing so many different groups, and that absolutely all the time challenges your own prejudices. And the difficulty, really, is lots of people don't actually get that opportunity, do they? I was quite concerned some time ago. I heard about a school where the school arranged a visit to a local mosque. And a number of the young people, their parents wrote into the school and refused the trip. because they didn't think it was right they should go to a mosque. And I thought that was pretty depressing, really. Because again, I've had the great opportunity of visiting many mosques, talking to many Muslims about their faith. And what's always struck me is, gosh, how much is there is in common. When you look at things like the number of times they pray each day, their love of family, their love of community, the veneration of Jesus and the Virgin Mary. You know, as I say, what absolutely strikes me, gosh, how much we've actually got in common. And you know, but that's because I've had that, really had that opportunity to understand it. And therefore, I think, and it's also being positive about that. I mean, one of the great joys of Manchester, one of the great strengths of Manchester, is its diversity. You know, a recent study compared the number of languages spoken in Manchester against the population, and the conclusion was, it was, you know, this is one of the most diverse cities in the world, which I think is absolutely wonderful. So many people have come to this city you know, prospered. But the other great thing is, on the whole, all those people, on the whole, live in tolerance and peace. Yes, we have our moments. Yes, we have a level of hate crime. But overall, the enormously positive story, when you see so many ethnic conflicts around the world, is we've got a city where so many people, on the whole, get on, you know, get on with one another, show a huge amount of tolerance and understanding. Even today, you know, people say that, you know, the public doesn't support international aid. What was the figure about how much we've raised within 24 hours for the Philippines? Staggering, isn't it? So I think, you know, and I think it's really important that we're positive about that. I think it's disappointing we don't actually promote more, you know, the great diversity, the great strength of Manchester. The fact that diversity is a really positive thing. The fact that so many people have come to this city and prospered is a great thing. And this great British value, I think, of live and let live, which we take for granted, but sadly is so missing in many other parts of the world. And the other great thing we've got is the brand of Manchester. As I say, last week I was in Uganda. You go into the shanty towns, you go way into the bush, there's no electricity, there's, you know, really, really poor. What two words in the English language have they all heard of? Manchester United. Manchester United. So, you know, we've got a great power in a way, because, of course, another feature of our football teams is actually they bring together people from all sorts of different nations. So I think it's really important that, you know, we as people of faith actually celebrate that. But I also think it's important that we as people of faith make our own efforts actually to reach out, to try and understand the outsider, to try and understand perhaps that group of people, that religion, that you may have got a particular impression about, that you may have got a stereotype about. And it's really important, I think, that all the churches really work together. And I know there's tremendous work being done in Manchester of all sorts of different faiths coming together. But, you know, for me, it's really, really important, isn't it? You know, we can't solve. You look at the situation in Syria, and as a Christian or just anybody of good faith, you think, what can we do about that? You know, what can we do? How do you solve that? You can't, can you? But what you can do, I think, in your own local community, as your own church, is try to be reaching out to other churches, to other groups, and try and build that. And I think that leads to the sort of, you know, the final theme, which for me is about, you know, very active communities. If you want to try and really avoid that sort of prejudice and that sort of alienation, and that sort of loneliness which can develop in communities, where people feel isolated, where people sort of retreat behind their front doors, it is really important that we have sort of very active communities where there is lots of voluntary effort, where there's lots of really active churches. We have a charity, it's called the High Sheriff's Trust, the police are involved in. And the week before last, we had an application from a rock cafe in Breckmit in Bolton. I don't know if you know what a rock cafe is. Rock is redeeming our communities. I don't know how many know Deborah Green, but essentially, the story of this church was that I think they were down to 5 members, and they'd had a conversation about, do we close the church? And then they thought, no, what we'll do is open a rock cafe. So they opened this rock cafe on a Friday evening for local youngsters. Apparently the first night, a lot of the youngsters turned up having been drinking and having sniffing glue or whatever, and they were turned away and told, if you want to come in here, you need to clean up your act, and they actually came back the next week. And after a year, they'd completely changed their ways. And but then they'd opened another night. They'd opened a mother and toddler group. They'd opened up a lunch club. They'd opened Rock Laundrette. I said, what's Rock Laundrette? they said, well, actually, there's people on this estate who, have they got a washing machine, can't afford to use it, or haven't got a washing machine. So they actually installed a washing machine in the basement of the church. And I thought it was really wonderful. And they actually said, we've also got a little kitchen, and we gave a job to this local lady to be the kitchen manager, and it's completely transformed her life. And we said, well, tell us about that. And they said, well, she's actually outside. So they brought in this lady, and again, it would have been very easy to stereotype her. She was clearly from a deprived community, not the healthiest looking woman. On the other hand, when she got talking, gosh, and she told a story about how throughout her life, everybody had told her she was useless. Her parents had told her she was useless. Her school had told her she was useless. The man she was living with who abused her told her she was useless. And then this rock cafe offered her a job as a kitchen manager. And she said, every morning I wake up and feel really, really positive because I'm going to run the kitchen. And I've got to be honest, I thought that was an amazing story about a local church really energising a community, bringing people together. I think it's a crucial issue about younger people and older people. And the trouble is, over recent years, and I know some of you may have heard me say this before, but I do think it's really important. We went through a period where we told the public, you are customers. You are customers of the police. You are customers of your school. Here's a league table. Hold these people to account. Watch if they're going to achieve their targets. It's nonsense, isn't it? You know, we are not customers, we are citizens. And the most successful places is where everybody plays their part and where we take personal responsibility, where wonderful people are youth leaders, where people, you know, are prepared to open youth clubs or get involved in the scouts or involved in youth coaching, whatever it might be. Even if it's just clearing your own snow from in front of your front door instead of expecting the council to do it. But I think this is really, really powerful. And Sir Robert Peel said, the police are the people are the police. The police merely take on full-time duties that are incumbent on every citizen for the public good. He said that back in 1829, and I think it's just as powerful today. So we have really stressed again in GMP about the importance of volunteers and people getting involved. It's not because we're short of money, and therefore we need some people to come and help us out for free. It is much more powerful than that. It is about, you know, working with local people, giving people more power and responsibility, and having really active communities. And we know that in really active communities, people actually feel safer and get more engaged. So I've covered a number of themes here. I've tried to explore some of the dilemmas about being a police officer, and actually to try to draw out that it is perfectly possible to be a committed Christian, a committed person of faith, and at the same time be an effective police officer, because it is about being clear about your own vocation, it is about being clear about your own standards, and it is about enormous opportunities every day to show compassion and patience and to actually change communities. I've highlighted really some of the dilemmas though about being a police officer and some of the dilemmas about being a leader. But it doesn't mean that we should not judge behaviour and that we should not punish, and that controlling offending in a humane criminal justice system based on a search for the truth is absolutely compatible with the gospel and with the Christian message. But it is about how you judge. It is about, if you're going to judge others, you need to think very carefully about how you judge yourself. And it is about being clear about our own values and ethics. It is about the daily battle against hypocrisy. But it is also about giving yourself space to actually examine your conscience and to check out in a busy world that you are trying to hold firm to that foundation of your own values and ethics. And as I say, I think that is particularly important for police officers, particularly important for other public servants. And it's particularly important for politicians and for leaders of the public service, people like me. I've spoken about that judging in some ways is related to the criminal justice system and the need for compassion and understanding in the criminal justice process, and that showing that understanding and having a real drive for rehabilitation is not about going soft. In some ways, it is actually much more difficult to confront offenders with their own behaviour. But it's also about the wider responsibility of the community, particularly through schemes like mentoring, of us actually all getting involved and recognising some of the causes behind offending, and prepared to work with other agencies to try and confront that. I've talked about how judging is often about prejudice, about we often judge others by stereotype, and the particular duty of people of good faith to actually reach out to the outsider, to the unknown, and make our own efforts to try and understand perhaps groups and individuals that we've not experienced, to be positive about diversity, and for churches and faith themselves to actually come together and increase understanding. And it's about celebrating the great diversity of Manchester. I've been really reassured by Pope Francis talking about all the doubts that he has. I found that really, because I got to be honest, I have lots of doubts. I think most Christians have lots and lots of doubts. When you see events like the Philippines, you think, gosh, how can that happen when you have a living God? And it was very reassuring to actually hear that, because, you know, I'm not standing up here to say that I'm some great person of faith, that I'm able to reconcile everything. But on the other hand, I am saying that my own personal faith gives me, in my own way, a set of values to live by, and my own particularly powerful vocation. I spent quite a lot today actually thinking about tonight and what I was going to say, which actually quite useful. But I actually got an email during the day from PC Daljit Singh, who I think is actually in the audience, which is a bit strange really, because he's a Sikh officer who's actually based in a Catholic school. And part of the email was actually to invite me to one of the masses at the school. And that, I don't know, in a strange way, isn't it? Strange things happen, isn't it? And somehow that email and that particular sort of juxtaposition between a Sikh officer working in a Catholic school and actually being inspired by the faith of that Catholic school, and then being prepared to contact the Chief Constable and saying good luck tonight. I don't know, I thought that was really pretty powerful about that particular officer, who I know is an incredibly dedicated officer, making his own personal effort. And he actually said, you know, I'd be really interested in your lecture tonight, because I think it's the battle that all of us face in terms of how you translate your own faith into the workplace, into your own daily life. So I don't think that he realised he would have such a starring position in my speech. But often, you know, I do find that little events happen, which, you know, seem to almost, you know, to be too rare to be a coincidence. Where almost it feels like, you know, somebody above is putting messages into you. And as I say, that particular juxtaposition today said something pretty powerful to me. So, as I say, I've really enjoyed this opportunity. It is quite a complex issue. I hope I've tried to highlight some of the dilemmas I face, but also, as I say, some of the duties upon all of us as people of faith to try and live out the gospel, to try and hold firm to our own set of values, and to try and work together to make this an even better city. Thank you.